Coming up next, In Your Dreams.
Hello, everyone, and boy, oh boy, do I have blessings for you today, bringing good news to you. You're listening to In Your Dreams, and In Your Dreams is a Christian dream interpretation show. Thank you so much for listening. I'm your host, God's Girl, and it's just an honor to be with you. We've got a great show today. We had Lynn. She called in from Chesapeake, Virginia. She had a dream that her son died. So see how the Lord dealt with her reoccurring dream and brought healing to her. And the big bang at the end of the show is Ethel Martin is with us, and God has given her visions and revelation for the listeners. So stay tuned. It's dream time. Welcome, Linda, In Your Dreams. How are you doing today?
I'm doing well.
Well, good, great. Okay, barely making it.
I'm making it.
That's good. That's good. So where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Chesapeake, Virginia.
Okay. All right, so you had a dream. Welcome to In Your Dreams, by the way. Thanks for calling. You had a dream about your son. Actually, you had three dreams.
Yeah.
And they all have the same result in the end. Well, why don't you tell us the first dream, and then we'll go on to the second dream. And do you remember when you had the first dream about your son?
The first dream would have been probably about a year and a half to 2 years ago.
Okay. And then the second one and the third one followed after that?
Yes, with the third one being within the last few months.
So they weren't necessarily in the same week. They are kind of ongoing.
Yes.
Within the last year and a half.
Yes.
Okay, all right. So the first dream you had, you can go ahead and tell us that.
The first dream, what I remember, it was a fairly short. It was
That's like, good. We like short ones.
Yes. And it just basically involved my son in a car accident, and the end result is he dies, and I woke up weeping.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a very sad feeling was over me when I woke up, and it felt so real,
mm-hmm.
that feeling of loss.
Now, when you had the dream with your son in the car accident, he died, was he in a car that he drives normally?
Yes. It was his car.
Was he with anybody, or did you see him, or did you just kind of wake up and know that that's what happened in the dream?
I just saw him vaguely, and I saw his white car that he had purchased.
Okay.
And it was an older car.
All right, so your son dies in a car accident in this dream, and you wake up crying. Now, your son is still alive, correct?
Yes, he is.
Okay, how old is he?
He is 23.
23, okay. Now, did he have this car at the time that you had the dream?
Yes, he did.
Okay, good. All right, so the second dream, you had a dream about your son, and this is, again, the end result. But tell that dream.
Okay, the second dream was more detailed, and I guess he was basically in a bar with his best friend.
Mm-hmm.
And
a nightclub, right?
Yes, a nightclub. And they're coming out, and it's like I'm witnessing everything that's going on. I'm watching.
Mm-hmm.
And he had been cheating with his best friend's wife, and his friend had found out, and he started beating on him. And he kept beating him until he just beat him to death, and he died.
Okay. So you see your son come out of a bar with his best friend's wife.
Yes.
And you're witnessing this, and you see his best friend find out what's going on, evidently, and beats him up. Does he have a weapon or anything, or is he just fighting him?
He's a very big man, and he just started beating up on him and just, you know, with his fist. And I just recall, you know, I cried out to him to quit beating on him and told him, you know, to the best friend that you have killed him. It was almost like I was speaking into that dream.
Right. Now, his best friend, well, let me start with the bar first. In this particular dream, when he was in the bar, was it a bar that you recognize? Was it a bar that he goes to normally? Or was it just the dream just showing he was in a bar?
The dream just showing he was in a bar.
Okay. And was his best friend really his best friend in real life at the time?
No, I just could determine from that there seemed to be a camaraderie there. Like there was some closeness.
So let's just say his best friend's name is Joe.
Okay.
It wasn't Joe in real life.
You
knew in the dream it was his best friend, or you knew in real life it was really his best friend in real life?
It seemed to be his best friend in real life.
Does he have a best friend in real life?
Yes, he does actually have a best friend, and he actually lives close to him.
Okay, so was that guy the one in the dream?
Yes.
Okay, and We'll call him Joe.
Okay, that would be good.
Okay, so Joe, his real best friend in real life, was really the guy in the dream.
Yeah.
That beat him up. And you said in real life, Joe's really big.
Yes.
What do you think of Joe? I mean, forget the fact that he's your son's best friend. Do you think he's a bad influence? Do you like him? What's your thoughts of him?
I don't know him real well. I have seen him on MySpace as a good friend.
Okay.
But I don't know him personally very well. But I do know my husband, or my son has been drinking, and so maybe that has something to do with the bar and the drinking and his friend's influence.
Right. Do you think you had this dream after you saw him on MySpace?
Yes.
Okay. So you may have figured out your son's got a MySpace page, and you see his best friend on there, what he calls his best friend. You don't know him too well, and the page is probably about drinking, or it shows that there's some drinking activity.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. So I would venture to say that you don't think Joe is too good of an influence on him.
That's very true.
Well, I just want the listeners to know that there are some very good people on MySpace. I have a MySpace page.
Yes.
Do you have one, Lynn?
Yeah. Yes, I do.
You do? Okay. All right. So anyway, so Joe's on MySpace. Now, is Joe somebody that he met, you think? You said your son was in the military?
Yes.
Or?
They're actually in military housing, and he's a few doors down from what I understand. They're real right in the same housing area.
Okay. So it might be like Joe could maybe represent his Navy friends?
Yes.
I mean, I'm just trying to, for some reason, the dream is picking Joe over a childhood friend your son grew up with.
Right.
So is Joe really married in real life?
Yes, he is.
Okay, in the dream, was it really his wife?
Yes, it was.
Okay, all right, so that's good. All right, so in the first dream, just a little recap, we've got your son in a car accident and he dies. It's the same car that he had really in real life. The second dream, you actually, close to when the dream was, you had seen your son on MySpace and you saw his friend. You knew there was a drinking environment. So you have this dream a little bit later that your son is cheating with his best friend, who we're calling Joe, with the wife. And they come out of a bar, they're drinking, and the best friend beats him up until he dies. And you're kind of like, you know, you're trying to just, I guess your heart's going out to your son, you know, and you're trying to speak into that situation. Yeah. And then you have a third dream that your whole family is at the beach. So tell us about that dream.
Okay, in the third dream, the whole family is out at the beach, including my son and his wife and two boys.
Mm-hmm.
Also my daughter and her boyfriend. But the only people I see playing in the waves of the ocean is my daughter, my son, and I. And we decide to come into shore, but when we get onto the land, my son is missing.
Mm-hmm.
We start looking everywhere for him. His boys are left alone on this large beach blanket.
Mm-hmm.
But we can't find him. We're thinking, well, maybe he went to the restroom. You know, we don't know where he's at. And then my daughter discovers and sees his wallet as it's washing up to shore. And she picks it up, and she's showing me. And I'm like, he wouldn't leave the wallet. You know, why would his wallet be floating up?
Right.
And so this realization, and it's not, it's like an unsaid, you know, this realization hits me that a shark has gotten him, and I just wake up weeping uncontrollably.
Mm-hmm.
The other two dreams I wept, but this one I really wept. There was such this feeling of loss that was just so deep down.
Mm-hmm.
I woke my husband up, and I couldn't seem to get it under control.
Right. Okay. Well, I'm going to go over your dreams with you. Normally, I don't do three dreams in a row. But I feel like they all mean the same thing. So it's usually best to break down a dream individually.
Okay.
But you've got the same type of theme in the dream. You've got the same end result, and you have the same feeling in the dream. And so I think if you've been struggling, you wrote to me and you said some background about your son. You said your son, who seems to be the focus of this dream, professed his faith when he was young, but he doesn't seem to want anything to do with God now. You said you're praying for his salvation and his return to the faith. He was raised in church for pretty much most of his life. He then walked away, married young, had children at a very young age, and he joined the Navy since he needed to support his family. And his job requires him to load bombs on airplanes.
Right.
Okay, so we've got some background here. In the first dream, you said he's in his car, he's in a car accident, and he dies, and you wake up weeping. All right, now, I had a dream a long time ago when I had a boyfriend. I went over to his house. I thought he was my boyfriend. And I went over to his house, and I didn't know this until I started learning how to interpret dreams, but I went over to his house. I found out he'd gone with another girl somewhere. And, of course, I had to do the right thing and break up with him because I just wasn't going to have that. But that was tragic for me because I had no clue. I was deceived, you know? And so in this particular instance in my life, that later I had the dream that he was really in his car, and his car, he'd gotten a car wreck and he had died. Well, that was all symbolism. He really did die to me. The person that I thought was my boyfriend, the relationship that I had with him, the interaction that I was going to have with him, he was dead to me. Okay, you're not going to be in my life and you're not going to do this. So I believe that your son dying in this car accident speaks of a part of your relationship that you had with him. You say that he was young, he got married, you know, he's in the Navy, he's walked away from God. The son that you knew at one time has pretty much, that spiritual part of him has died. Is that true?
Yeah.
So the person that you knew, the person that you raised, the child that you formed, you know, the man of God that you cultivated or tried to cultivate, he's no longer alive.
I can see that.
So do you see how when you come to that realization that, wow, my son's walked away from his faith. He's walked away from God. He's doing what he wants to do. He's got all these new friends. Mm-hmm. And he's, you know, totally just not even seeking the Lord. Do you see how that you could see that he's dead in that sense?
Yeah.
And so I think that they're a dream because a dream has him in his car. That represents his present life at that time. It wasn't like a fast red race car that might represent young danger, you know. It was really his car. And we know that he's not really dead as far as in the natural. So the dream couldn't have been prophesying anything because God's still giving him grace to be alive. So in the first dream, and did that bring a sense of loss to you? Does that grieve your heart?
Oh, yeah. It still grieves my heart. I mean...
Yeah, and your dreams are showing that. That's why they're continuing, because your son's situation has not changed. And so this same feeling that you had that brought this first dream on is continuing, and it will continue. These dreams will continue until either you change or your son changes. So we can't do anything about him, and we'll talk about that later, because he has free will, right?
Right.
So we can only change ourselves.
Exactly.
So we'll talk about that in a minute. So the second dream is cheating on with his best friend and his wife. Now, cheating on your best friend with his wife, what is that? That's adultery, right?
Right.
So, you know, that represents him being with a bad crowd, being in the wrong place, the wrong time. Sin is the wrong place, you know, with the wrong people, you know, rebellion away from God. It's just a whole environment. He's really on the devil's playground. He's in a bar.
Yeah.
In your dream. And so you're seeing him, okay, in this bad environment, an environment that brings consequences to your decisions, and you're kind of helpless. You're observing this whole thing, and in real life, you really are observing it. When you were on the internet looking at his MySpace,
yeah,
you're just observing it.
Yeah.
And so he's with these friends, and he's in this adulterous relationship. It just so happens to be someone that he calls his best friend. Well, the Holy Spirit's supposed to be our best friend, right?
Right.
So that could be symbolic for him cheating on God. And just this big bad enemy, Joe could be playing a big bad enemy, a big bad worldly enemy, taking his life. And we know that the Bible says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life, right?
That is correct.
Okay, so we know that there are consequences to this. And here we go again. He's dead in the end of this dream. Okay, the world system, that environment, that adulterous relationship has taken him out. But I do believe it's talking about spiritually. Eventually, if he doesn't change, and I don't say this lightly, but it's just the truth. Eventually, if he doesn't change, we know that it's going to bring a natural death. But right now, we're just talking about a spiritual death. Adam died spiritually long before he died naturally.
Yeah.
In the Old Testament. So in this third dream, basically, you've got the whole family at the beach. Okay, you're having this seemingly good time, you know, and it's your immediate family in the waves, okay? You said it was your son, your daughter, and you. Okay, his two kids are up on the beach on the blanket. That represents them being safe and sound. Okay, they're in a safe place. But so it's your immediate family, and you guys, you know, the waves come in. The waves can be symbolic of something that's, you know, a little bit turbulent.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And all of a sudden, he's lost. You can't find him. Panic stricken? I mean, am I way off here?
No.
Okay,
no,
so
that was the exact feeling of the whole.
Yeah, so this terrible sense of, where is he at? What's he doing?
Right.
Where did he go? You know, he wouldn't just leave his wallet.
Right.
You know, this isn't all we have left of him. It's his ID of who he used to be.
Wow.
Thank you, Holy Spirit. Who he used to be. This can't be all that we have left of him. And so in the dream's showing that the sharks got him. You think that the sharks got him, which can be symbolic for people in the world. There are loan sharks. There are, if you're swimming in the water can represent the world, the ocean, because Jesus said we're fishers of men. And so that can be the world. And the sharks swimming around can represent the enemy, because I don't want to be in no water with no sharks.
No.
And I don't want to be in real life with sharks either in my, you know, my pool or my sphere of atmosphere. So sharks are big, bad fish, and they're something that you not don't want to tangle with, and so they can represent, I believe, the enemy. And so your son, here we go again, you come to the realization that, wow, a shark must have gotten him. He must have been taken out.
Yeah.
And you have this sense of loss and this sense of grieving, and there's absolutely nothing that you can do about his situation. Each time you wake up feeling lost and you're crying and there's a deep weeping, each time in the dreams he shows up dead. Each time the theme is the same. So the dreams are showing what your heart is going through as a mother and where you're at and what you're dealing with based on your son's spiritual status, basically.
Yeah, I agree.
So there's a couple of things that we can look at. So do you feel like that's what your dreams mean?
I definitely identify with that.
Okay. So if you didn't feel that way in your heart and this was like clueless to you and your son, you know, was okay, I would say possibly there's a small chance that they could be prophetic, but they're not. So I don't believe that this is going to happen to your son because God's word brings us hope. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know, there were seeds. Remember the story in the Bible where there was the parable of the sower and God, Jesus talked about different types of seeds that fell on different types of grounds. And so do you believe that your son was really saved, truly saved? Or do you believe that he just kind of went with it because that's what the family did?
I truly believe that he went with it, but I also so much believe there was a call in his life.
Mm-hmm.
And toward his later teenage years, he just really started, it was evident. He started walking away. I was basically fighting to keep him on track with school and everything.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, did you ever see that real love for Jesus?
No.
Okay. So then we know that's okay because we know what we have to work with, right?
Right.
Okay. So if you never saw that real love for Jesus, I was saved when I was 9, but I didn't grow in the Lord until I was 27. I know if I would have died, I would have gone to heaven because I made Jesus my Savior. And, you know, that's all that's required is
right.
That you make him your Lord. And it's our works that we're rewarded for afterwards. But nevertheless, I was introduced to him at 9, but I started growing at 27. So with your son, he may very well could have been introduced to him and may not start growing until he's 27. I don't care what anybody says about me. I know that I was saved. I know that I accepted Christ as my Savior. I know I did that by my own free will choice. But anyways, only your son really, really knows what he accepted Christ, if he meant it or not. If he did mean it, and then, you know, he kind of sprung up quick a little bit or kind of adhered a little bit and then kind of withered away, he's one of those different types of seeds that were sown. But I want you to be free tonight with your feelings that you have, because we know that God doesn't override our free will. And we know that even though your son may have been saved and he may have turned his back on God, or he may have never been saved, only he knows that. And so if he was never saved, then he hadn't really turned his back on God, right?
Right.
So he just never was. But But he's God's creation. He's God's. God created him in your womb, and God ordained for him to be called, to be something. Like you said, he's got a call of God on his life, like all of us do.
Right.
But other than prayer and our weapons that are not carnal, but that are spiritual weapons, that's really the only thing that we can do, okay? So what have you been doing so far as standing on God's word, or how have you been tackling this problem in your life as far as scripturally with your son?
I have been praying. I actually have him on the church prayer team's list of prayer.
Okay, that's good. So he's on the prayer list.
Yes, and that's pretty much the extent other than ministering to him as far as just accepting him unconditionally and loving him.
That's good.
Him and his family come over, and we do have family get-togethers, and I do email him when he's out to sea, so I try to keep the slate clean and no issues there.
Right.
And so just loving him, and he went through a really tough time last summer, and we were there for him for that time.
What kind of tough time? Just a brief?
Briefly, it looked like his wife and him were going to get a divorce.
Okay.
And he was having a hard time because she took off with the children and wouldn't let him see the children.
Mm-hmm.
And we remained neutral in that situation.
That's good.
But we still ministered a little bit about God and his love for him, and told him we were praying for the situation, and praise God, they did end up back together again.
Well, that's great. That's great. But you're still having these dreams, and so you don't have any peace, do you?
No, I guess the biggest thing is that my concern has been if we're never promised a tomorrow.
Right.
And because I don't know where he is with God, other than I know it appears he walked away, and I don't know if he actually, you know, truly accepted God, or if he just walked away and said, well, you know, I'm going to take it and taste the world and do what I want to right now.
Well, were you with him? Did he go to a youth camp and say the prayer of salvation, or did you lead him to the Lord yourself, or do you just assume he got saved somewhere along the line?
He went to a function with the church, and he came back and said that he had accepted the Lord.
Okay. Well, then we'll believe that he's saved. He just hasn't realized that he needs to. Sometimes I didn't know when I wasn't following the Lord that I wasn't following the Lord. I thought that I was okay.
Yeah.
I just thought my parents were kind of on the deep end with all the, you can't wear pants and you can't, you know, wear makeup and all that stuff. So, you know, he may just not know. So we'll just assume the best, because everybody has different standards for Christianity. And he's only exposed to the standard, really, that he understands, you know, because sometimes we can speak things to kids and or to people, and you just don't get it,
right?
You know, or it's just going in one ear and out the other. And then one day something happens and a light bulb goes off, and it all makes sense somehow to them.
Right.
So, and that's the revelation of the Holy Spirit. So I just wanted to bring some scriptures to your mind, because I want to help you be in a place where you can find some freedom. The Bible says in Proverbs 17:25 that a foolish son brings grief to his father and the bitterness to the one who bore him. And then Proverbs 10:1 says a wise son brings joy to his father, but a foolish son grief to his mother. So when kids are like that, or it seems that they're being foolish and they're out there in the world, it's going to bring grief and it's going to bring bitterness. So God's not saying that you shouldn't have ever felt that, but he doesn't want you to continue walking that way. He doesn't want you to continue to have that weepingness in your spirit, because he wants you to live victorious as a Christian, and peace is something that belongs to you. And I'm not a mother, so I can't even imagine what you're going through, but God is a father.
Yeah.
And God does know what you're going through, and his word addresses that. So it's okay to feel that, but at some point, you need to get past it. And so the Bible says that God understands wayward children and the hurting that they bring. In Isaiah 1:2, God says, as he even has children that don't obey, he says, hear, O heavens, listen, O earth, for the Lord has spoken. I reared children and brought them up, but they have rebelled against me. So God, you know, the Israelites, he reared them up and they rebelled against him. So he knows how it feels to be rejected And so he understands how you feel as well. But he wants us to know, too, that the battle is not yours. And that's what I think makes the difference. You know, yeah, you can pray, and you have to pray. You have to do that. But there has to be a line. It's kind of like, I guess, a police officer, you know?
Yeah,
you go out there and you fight that battle, and you try to, you know, keep the peace in the streets, and you try to, you know, take out the bad guys. But there's got to be a line where you just leave that stuff at the job. You can't bring it home and let it, you know, ruin your family. And I think that there has to be a peace in your heart and a confidence in your heart that God, because he's in covenant with you, is going to come through. And I'm not saying that you don't have that or you do, because I don't know the extent and the depth of your heart. But when we're confident in God, it's like, I don't know how you're going to do it, Lord, but you're just going to do it. And the enemy tries to bring worry on us. He tries to bring fear. Tomorrow is not promised. When tomorrow is not promised comes up, I would say, well, you know what? I'm praying for grace for my son, so I believe that tomorrow is promised for him. Because even the enemy used scriptures against Jesus. He just twisted them.
Yeah.
You know, so be careful who's talking to you. And when you think these thoughts, think, okay, is this thought motivating me to have faith in God and to believe for my son, or is it motivating me to be worried, and is it trying to bring me down? And usually the motive is what will detect what source it's coming from. So remember that the battle is with the enemy, and it's not our battle as mothers and fathers. And like I said earlier, I'm sure there's a lot of people out there that have sons and daughters or loved ones that are lost. It's not your battle. It's God's. You have to say, God, you created this child. You gave him to me to steward over. I did the best with what I had at the time and with what I knew to do. I tried to sow your word into him. And now I'm turning him over to you, Lord. You take care of him. You lead his path. You dictate who comes across his pathway. You cut off everybody that you don't want in his presence. You see what I'm saying?
I do.
And say, God, you know what? He's not my son, even though he is. But, I mean, he's yours. You know, he's your... You're the father of all created beings. And so he's yours, so you take him. And this is a good scripture for that, too, with, as far as it being the battle being God's and not ours. Isaiah 49:25 says, but this is what the Lord says. Yes, captives will be taken from warriors, and plunders retrieved from their fierce. I will contend with those who contend with you, and your children I will save. And so you're in covenant with God. You are, I mean, look at how he treated David's kid, Solomon. Solomon got this whole spill of blessing just because he was David's kid.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, that's true.
And so there's generational blessings for children. It's his seed. You know, God is taking care of his promises are generational. He didn't just promise to Abraham, but he promised to Abraham's seed, the blessings. And so they're passed down. And curses can be passed down too, so I don't want to be out of balance. But I'm just saying, know that God says that he will contend with them and the children he will save. He was speaking to people that he was in covenant with, okay? Because this is in Isaiah. So have faith. God, you know what? I'm in covenant with you. I'm your daughter. You love me. This is my son, is your grandson, basically. You want him saved just as much as I do. Teach me to pray scriptural prayers and to be able to warfare on earth in the natural, to co-labor with you to the best of my ability so that your will can be performed in his life. And so earlier we were talking, and, you know, you were talking about keeping the lines of communication open.
Yeah.
That's really good because you need to strive to do that, because when they do come to you, you want to be able to have the pulpit to speak to them and to sow more into them. And another thing you should do is to strive to keep your own walk with the Lord vital and fresh and not allow the enemy to use this to cause yourself to be untrusting in your confidence in God, because we have to have confidence in God, because the Bible says that, you know, that he requires faith. If it's not from faith, it's not pleasing to the Lord. So we got to just say, God, you know what? You are a big God. You can do this. Nothing is too big for you. You can handle anything. It's not impossible for you. It just looks impossible. But you know what, Lynn? Most people that have the worst lifestyle end up having the greatest testimony later.
That's true, and I agree with that. I have met people where they weren't walking with God, and then their testimony is fantastic, how God has worked in their lives.
Right.
God's Girl will be right back after this short break.
A brother that's been, well, I don't even want to tell you where he's been, but when it's all said and done, his testimony will be powerful. And so we don't want to negate the fact that, yeah, there is the reality of turning your back on God because there are consequences for sin, but we also know that God forgives rebellion and that God really is his only solution for your son. So just continue to pray consistently for him as you have been, but don't pray necessarily for what you want as a parent, but what God wants for a child's life.
Okay.
You know, because Romans 8:26 says, it says, in the same way that the Spirit helps us in our weakness, we do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groans and words it cannot express. So if you can, you know, say, God, you know, whatever your will is for him, you are the one that really he owes his whole life to. You are the one that created him for a purpose, and he's not fulfilling that purpose to the best of his ability right now. You are the one that has ordered his steps, that knows his ways. You are the one, Lord, that, you know, has control. He's in the palm of your hand, really, because the Bible says that no man can pluck him out. So I would pray, Lord, just help me when I pray to pray that your will would be done, and that I would pray what you want for him. So don't get in a routine with your prayer. Try to say, God, how do you want me to pray for him today? See what God lays on your heart. And you got to always keep hope last of all, because hope must always be kept in a loving God who desires to restore that child. Don't lose your hope. And don't let the world discourage you, you know, because the world, you look around and say, oh, he's hanging out with his friends, you know, he's out drinking, whatever. Just anticipate, God. I'm just anticipating you're going to do something great. I don't know when, how, or what means you're going to use to do it, but you're able to do it. And this is what I would do. You know the story of the prodigal son, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is another thing that I would do. And this may not sound very nice. So if the listeners are out there listening, thinking, wow, lady, you know what I mean? But really, you know, what does it take for us to come to the Lord? It usually takes something really bad, you know, a broken heart or financial problems or, you know, the death of a child. Or there are some people out there that come around easy, you know, just have it soaring from, you know, age 8. But for me, it took a man breaking my heart, and I wanted to kill myself at one point. And so it's sad, but a lot of times it takes for us to hit rock bottom and to really feel like there's no hope whatsoever before we actually turn to the one that can meet the need. And so I would pray myself, you know what, Lord? Don't give him any peace. You know what I mean? Make everything he does hard, because the sooner that he gets to that rock bottom, I wouldn't be praying blessings on my son. I wouldn't be praying, right, you know, bless him financially in his job. You know, give him, give him grace to live, but break him down, Lord. You know what I mean? I would be praying, give him dreams of hellfire and brimstone. I would be praying that the enemy would be able to run in his life for a short period of time. But, you know, the Word says that all things work together for the good of those that love God and called according to his purpose. So I would be praying that the Lord would break him down.
Okay.
Because that's your choice. I'm not pushing that on you. But I think that the sooner your little world gets shaken up,
yeah,
the sooner it is that you come back to God. Because the Bible says, what does it profit a man or a woman if they gain the whole world but yet lose their soul?
Yeah.
And so what is it if you got a great marriage? What is it if you got a good job? Bring in a little bit of money. You know, you got your health. You ain't got no need for God that way.
Exactly.
And the worst thing a parent can do, I believe, after their son or daughter gets to that place, whether it's because they pray it on them, you know, or whether it's because God just does it without our prayers, is that the parents try to save the kid. Mm-hmm. And they want to bail him out of the financial problem. They want to bail him out of this, bail him out of that. I would try to be, like I said, I'm not there yet, so I can't say what I would do for sure, but I would try to be tough love. Well, these are the consequences that come with the decisions that you made. So you have to suffer the consequences, but you know what? God can pull you out. You know, look to God. Let God be the Savior. Parents are so busy saving their kids. Mm-hmm. And I think it's okay if you save your kids if you know, because you know your child, if you know that there's a true repentance.
Right.
But bottom line is some of the kids can play their parents.
Oh, yes.
They manipulate. They know that, oh, mom, dad will always be there for me. Mm-hmm. And there's really no true repentance. So it's a matter of where their heart is at. Is there really a true repentance? Are they really looking to God? Okay, well, you know what? Yeah, maybe we can help you with this. You know, God's been good to us. We have some, you know, we have some things that we can do to help you with this. But if there's no repentance, true repentance, I say let God get them out of it totally. And I know God uses people, but, you know, you don't want to keep saving your kids to where they have no need for God.
Right.
So
then we take the place of God, because then we become their Savior.
Exactly. And so, you know, and then you have to ask yourself too, Lynn, you know, how do you feel about where your son's at? What kind of feelings? I mean, do you have any guilt? Do you have any, are you beating yourself up? I mean, what's going on in your heart?
I, a lot of times, do wonder if there was something I could have done different. And I guess I do beat myself up more on that because I wonder, well, maybe I should have been, you know, maybe they should have gone to Christian school, or I should have homeschooled, and I tend to think of if there could have been something I could have done different that would have changed the outcome.
Right. Do you think you were a good mom?
I do think I was a good mom. The best I knew how to be.
Well, you know what? Then you're free. You know, when you have things like that come up, you have to say, no, I'm not thinking about that. Because what does the Bible say? It says to press ahead. You know, Paul said, don't look behind. He said, press on towards the mark of the prize of the high calling of Christ Jesus. You know, forgetting those things that are behind, pressing ahead. And so you have to forget those things that are behind, especially when they're trying to pull you down. You know, I think if you were a good mother and you had the ability to do things for him that you could have, it still wouldn't have guaranteed him being where he's at now or where he's not at, you know. And if you feel in your heart that you were the best mother that you could have possibly been, then when these thoughts come up, well, maybe you should have done this or maybe you should have done that, well, that's probably the enemy talking to you, because usually the enemy talks to you in third person.
Okay.
So, and even if you're saying, I should have done this or I should have done that, you just can't go there. You can't afford to go there. So I would just, you know, really watch my feelings on guilt.
Okay.
And have you read the Purpose Driven Life book?
Yes, I have. It's a very good book.
It talks about how some things run your life. Some people live their life based on guilt. Some people live their life based on, you know, remorse. Some people live their life based on fear. And so you have to really just judge your motives and keep yourself in line. And when you come to the realization that he is God's, these dreams, I believe they'll stop.
Okay.
Because the grief and the weeping is in you, in the mother part of you.
Yeah.
You know? So if you really come and you get this revelation, God, I can't go against his free will. I did the best I could as a mother. I know that I did the best that I could with what I had to work with at the time. You know what? I am not responsible for another human being's decisions. And you know what? He is yours. And I turn him over to you. I have confidence in you. And you know, peace, the enemy will try to steal our peace and steal our joy. So I'm not saying there won't be a fight. But I would pray that you would ask the Lord to heal your heart from anything that may be germinating underneath. Because, you know, the Bible says that we have to cast out and cast down thoughts that are high and lofty and that are against his wisdom and his knowledge.
Okay.
And that's an active response. I know I'm sitting here today and I thought several things and I had to cast them down, you know? And we know the Word says that, but do we really do it?
Right.
It's when we really do it, that's the warfare. Thinking about doing it, that's not the warfare. But when we really do it, you know what? No guilt. You're not staying here today in Jesus' name. I was a good mom.
Yeah.
I raised him in the Word. I took him to church. You know?
I agree.
You know, weeping? You know, no, you're not staying here today because he made that on his own free will choice.
Wow.
And I can't change him. Only he can change him. And only God can change him. So, Lord, I just offer him up to you today. I'm not crying over him because I have confidence in you. You have to do like the Bible says that David said, soul, why art thou discouraged of me? You have to walk around. You're going to have to talk to yourself. I'm serious.
Yeah.
Talk to yourself. Talk to the enemy. And talk to God.
Okay.
And do not let the enemy bombard you with thoughts, feelings. And, you know, I'm not saying that some of your grief isn't very well legitimate out of the mother-son relationship, but it should, I don't know how long grief should stay, but there comes a point where you got to say enough or it'll take you out.
Exactly.
You know, who wants to know a Christian that's sad?
True.
You know, who wants to know a Christian that's depressed?
True.
You know, aren't we supposed to have the joy of the Lord? And I'm not even saying that we're not going to go there, because the Bible says that we're going to have persecution and suffering.
Right.
So I'm not saying we're never going to feel it, but I'm just saying that your testimony and what God wants to use you for depends on you being able to win this battle. And that's all it is. It's a battle. And you're just helping the Lord fight it. You're just being God's mouthpiece on this earth. You're speaking the word, and you're going out in faith and in victory, and you're loving him. You're keeping the lines of communication open, but you're having confidence in your God. And so
Every time a thought comes up, I just say, Lord, I turn them over to you. There's no grief in my heart. Lord, if there is any grief left, take that grief and turn it into joy. The Lord says, you give me, what is this, gladness for ashes, or I don't know that particular scripture too well. But
no, it's in Isaiah.
Something good. Joyce Myers wrote a book on it.
Yes. Beauty for ashes.
Beauty for ashes. Preach, Sister Lynn.
Yes.
Beauty for ashes. And so, you know, here's my ashes, God. Give me beauty for my ashes. Replace and do a work on the inside of me.
Yeah.
So can I pray for your healing?
Yes, please. I'm ready.
God, we just praise you, Father, Lord, that you are the Father of all living, God. We thank you, Lord, that you knew us before we were even formed, God. Lord, I just pray for Lynn today, God, and mothers out there or fathers out there that may be suffering, Father, in the same area, Lord. Lord, we thank you, Father, Lord, for the emotions that you've given us, Lord. We don't deny them for a second, God, that you've given us happiness and you've given us a melancholy and you've given us a sadness and you've given us joy and you've given us all these different types of emotions, God. I believe there's like 80 of them, Lord. But, you know, Lord, we don't want to let the grief eat away in our hearts, God. And Lord, I just pray for that grief that's in there, Lord. In the name of Jesus, Lord, if it's been there longer than it should have, God, Lord, and it's an oppression from the enemy, Lord, I just right now, Father, with my hand, I reach into her heart, God. And Lord, I pull it up and I command every root that may be in her heart, God, Lord, I just pull it out in the name of Jesus. And I ask that the Holy Spirit, God, would sever it in Jesus' name, Lord. I pray that every place where the root of grief, weeping, or sorrow may have infiltrated there, Father, Lord, I pray that you'd fill it, God, with your spirit, with your peace, and with your joy, God. Lord, I pray that the hand of God, Lord, would just reach in and touch your heart, Father, and massage it to be thriving and replace it with confidence in who you are. And Lord, I just ask, God, if the enemy in any way, shape, or form is surrounding her, Father, twisting your words, God, Lord, we just command them to take flight in the name of Jesus, Lord. Your word says one can chase 1,000 and two can put 10,000 to flight. In Jesus' name, we command warring angels to come in and to take them away from her presence and protect her, God. Guard her, Father, Lord. You've given your angels charge over us. And I thank you, God, that you are able to replace it with the joy of the Lord, which will be her strength. God, Lord, we just love you today, Father. We pray for her son. Your word says to pray that you would put laborers in the pathway. It says to pray, God, that they would have ears to hear. It says to pray, God, that the veil would be lifted from their eyes and they come out of darkness into the marvelous light. Your word says that no one can come into the Father unless the Father draws them first. And we just pray all these things over her son and others listening and their family members, God, Lord. And we just expect you to do great and mighty things, God, in your time, in your season. We thank you ahead of time for the prodigal son returning. And Lord, we thank you for everything that you're about to do in his life. And have already started, Lord, because we know that the seed germinates under the soil long before we see a blade or a head of grain, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Sorry, I didn't mean to pray the whole Bible there.
That's okay. That revelation was wonderful. Thank you so much.
You're welcome so much. So do you think you know what your dream means?
Yes, exactly. It helps a lot.
All right, I'm your host, God's Girl. If anybody out there has a dream that they'd like to share or a dream that they'd like help interpreting, my email address is godsgirl@wrrw.fm. Once again, godsgirl@wrrw.fm. All right, everyone, it's an exciting moment. We have with us on the phone Prophetess Ethel Martin. The Word of God says, blessed are those that have the feet that bear good news. And she has good news for some. We just want to just take the time to be able to just usher in the presence of God, because God, he has things he wants to say to you. He has messages he wants to communicate to you. But even although this is a word in season, please know and be reminded that your healing and deliverance is because of the blood of Jesus on the cross 2,000 years ago. So, Lord, we just praise you, God. We just lift you up, Father, and we just say, let your name be glorified today. Father, we thank you for the revelation that you've given for your children, for the people, God, that you love and you hold dear to your heart. And, Lord, we just thank you for ministering to their spirit. We're honored to be a part of what you're doing, God, and we just give you all the praise and all the glory in the name of Jesus. How you doing, Ethel?
praise the Lord, just fine.
That's good. Thanks for taking your time to share. I'm so excited to have you on, as always. So I want to start with the first vision about the brain tumor.
Yes, God is so good and so faithful. God shows me a vision of someone that has a tumor on their brain. And the Lord says, if you will just praise him, then he's going to remove that tumor.
Awesome.
He loves you so much, and praise will make a difference, because God inhabits the praises of his people.
Wow, that's powerful. The second vision that you had?
Yes. God gives me a vision of someone, their left knee. The doctor said you need a knee replacement, but the word of the Lord says, who are you going to believe, the report of the Lord or the doctor? So God says, praise him, and he's going to take care of that knee for you, and you won't have to have any surgery. Just believe him, trust him, and praise him, and he's going to fix your knee. Okay?
So they won't have to have the knee surgery. Wow.
No surgery. God gives me a vision. There is someone that has a problem in their neck. On the right-hand side of the back of your neck, there is a bone that's out of place. And God says, you're restored. He's putting the bone right back in the correct position. And he's healing you. Praise be to God. Next vision that God gives me is someone is preparing to get a facelift. And I believe the Lord is saying, don't do it, because it's not going to come out right. It's going to disfigure your face. I don't know who you are, but God does. And his word says, don't mutilate your body. So, God bless you. Whoever you are, I'm believing that you're not going to have it done.
So what does he show you, a face that's messed up?
Actually, it's the lips are distorted, botched.
Don't do it. Don't have that surgery.
Do it. Don't have the surgery.
And no, you don't need to find a new doctor that's better. The word of the Lord is don't have the surgery, right? Because some people think like me, Ethel, oh, I'll just go get a new doctor. No, don't have the surgery.
God says don't do it, because he sees the whole picture, and the surgery is not going to turn out good. You'll be disfigured.
Amen.
Someone has a cane that is limping and walking with this cane, and this cane is unusual shaped. To me, it's unusual. It's not the standard type cane. And I believe the Lord is saying, if you will just throw that cane down and start walking, you'll walk right into your healing. God's going to restore that condition, whatever. He's going to heal you and make you whole.
Awesome.
Just praise him. He loves to be praised. That's how you thank him, praise him.
That's right, that's right.
Praise the Lord. The Lord shows me that there are men and women of his children in the body of Christ that are seeking mates. They want to be married. So the devil is going to bring decoys in your path to try to get you derailed from doing what God wants you to do and get hooked up with the wrong individual and miss the perfect one that God's chosen for you, because he's handpicked someone for you. So I suggest that you seek God's face to make sure you don't get the wrong one.
No, you don't want the wrong one.
And I don't want you to have the wrong one. So, like John said, is this the one or is there another one to come?
Right.
So please pray about the individual so you don't get mixed up and mess up your life. God bless you. In this vision, someone, I believe it's on the left side of your mouth, there's a tooth that has broken off and you've forgotten about it, and the gum has grown over the roots of the tooth. And I believe the Lord's saying, go to the dentist and get it checked, because you're going to have much, much difficulty with the roots where the gum has grown over. So seek your dentist. That's good advice from the Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah. Boy, he's really moving tonight, folks.
I know.
Thank you so much. In this vision, there is a baby in a crib. And I really don't know the age of this child, because God hasn't revealed it. mm-hmm. or if it's male or female. But this child is very fussy, and legs and arms are swinging, and this child is in a Christian home. And I don't know if it's 6 months old, I can't tell the age, but this child has a hole in the heart, and the parents don't know it. And the Lord said, if you will anoint this child with oil and lay hands on the baby's heart, then he's going to close that hole, the hole that's in the baby's heart.
Mm.
So please get the oil out and go lay hands on this child.
So the parents don't know it's there?
No, the parents don't know that, the baby has a hole in its heart.
Right.
So get the oil, pray, and God will close that hole up, and the baby will be fine.
Mm. And what about, we've talked about things before when you've talked about people losing and not and continuing to stand in faith. Isn't it true that whenever the Lord does something miraculous like that, there's always usually a test later and people really need to just stand and hold on to that healing?
Yes, yes.
Don't think just because your baby gets fussy again that God has not healed that child. Just stand
That's
firm.
Right.
Don't
yes.
move. Well, thank you so much. I'm your host, God's Girl. If anybody out there has a dream that they're interested in interpreting, please send me an email. My email address is godsgirl@wrrw.fm.
I'm your host, God's Girl, and I'd just like to take the time to tell you that I've got some great news for you today. The news is that Jesus Christ is Lord. If you don't know Him, you know who you are. You know that you don't know Him. But if that's you and you'd like to know Him, just accept Jesus Christ into your heart. Just say, Lord, I believe that you were born of a Virgin Mary, that you are God. I believe you died on the cross for my sins, rose again on the third day, and have the power to give me eternal life. Amen. That's all you got to do is just ask Christ to come into your heart and then turn your whole life over to Him. God bless you and welcome to the family.
In Your Dreams is produced in the studios of New Horizons 3000 and is copyright protected. Archive copies of this show are available on the web at wrrw.fm. For information on dream interpretation seminars, please email godsgirl@wrrw.fm. That's godsgirl@wrrw.fm.